That's Can I put it in my pocket?
Okay, it's time to start a session of block cipher 2. We have three talks. First talk is a new algorithm for unbalanced meter-in-the-middle array program by Ivica Nikolic and Yu Sasaki. A talk is given by Ivica.
Thank you. Okay, so first let's try to understand the meaning of this unbalanced, excuse me, meter-in-the-middle attack with a simple example. Imagine you were lucky enough or smart enough and managed to invert the compression function of SHA-256. Say in 2 to the 64, you can find pre-image for the compression function. And now you want to convert this pseudo pre-image attack into a pre-image attack for the hash function. So how you do it? Well, of course, use the well-known meet-in-the-middle attack. So basically, you have you are using two compression function calls. This is your IV. This is the target hash that you want to find pre-image for. So first, you create a set of 2 to the 96 pre-images using the pseudo pre-image attack. You store this set in the hash table. And then from the IV, you shoot with 2 to the 160 images for the first compression function, because the middle space is only 256 bits wide. You can hope to find, on average, one collision. Okay? So this is the typical meet-in-the-middle attack. So why is it unbalanced? Because as you have seen, the cost of this function, it's 2 to the 64, whereas the cost of this function is only 1. So that's why we call it unbalanced meet-in-the-middle problem. Okay? That's the only thing. So this function costs more than this function. Everything else is pretty much the standard. Now, Diffie and Helmer introduced the meet-in-the-middle problem some 40 years ago, and they called it meet-in-the-middle. They introduced the problem for finding the keys of double deaths. So they call it meet in the middle because they are indeed the two encryptions with two independent keys for meeting in the middle. However, today when we talk about meet in the middle, we have in mind some more general meaning. For example, the latest attack on AES, the Demirci-Seljuk meet in the middle attacks, have nothing to do with meeting in the middle of the cipher. It's not that you have, I don't know, 8 round AES and then after 4 rounds these two encryptions are meeting. No. There you have an online offline phase where you create some pre-computation table, and then in the online phase you shoot into this table. Okay, so it's not meeting in the middle. So basically today, when we say when we talk about meet in the middle, what we mean is nothing more than a collision surge between two functions. Okay, whenever you hear the word meet in the middle, forget about meeting in the middle of the cryptographic primitive, but think about collision surge between two functions. And that's how we're going to regard this problem here in this talk. And that's how you should see the problem always. So we are trying to find a collision between two functions, f and g. So we're trying to find two values, x and y, such that f of x equals g of y. That's all. Now we can differentiate several types of collisions between f and g. The most common types when f and g have a range larger than domain. That's the first type, and the second time when the range is not larger than domain. And in this talk, I'm going to focus on the second case. And further, we can simplify it even further, and then we can assume that we are dealing only with n-bit functions f and g, and we are trying to find a collision between these two functions, but we are looking for unbalanced collisions. So we introduce this value of r, so we assume that one of the functions, let's say g, is r times more expensive than f. So in the previous example of SHA-2, g was 2 to the 64 times more expensive than f. Okay, so r equals 2 to the 64 divided by 1 equals 2 to the 64. Okay, so now let's take a look at the state of the art. What are the best known algorithms that solve the unbalanced collision search problem? Well, when I equals one, actually, this is the balanced collisions. Of course, we use the Floyd cycle finding algorithm, and we can find collision between two functions in time 2 to the n divided by 2, and this algorithm doesn't require any memory. When R equals 1, as we saw in the case of SHA-2, we use the meet in the middle. So basically, we store square root of n divided by R images of G. We store in a hash table, and then we produce around square root of R times n images of F to shoot in the hash table. And because the meet in the middle space is n, when you multiply the sizes of these two sets, you're going to get n. So on average, you can assume you got one collision. So you can see why we disbalance here the number of calls and number of calls, because G costs R times small. So even though we produce this many images of G, because it costs R, so the total time complexity for producing the first set is square root of Rn, same as in the second case. Okay? So this meet in the middle requires time of square root of Rn and memory square root of n divided by R. In general case, I'm quite sure that all of you know that the meet in the middle follows the famous trade-off, time times memory equals n. But keep in mind, the time cannot be less than square root of r, and you can easily show this, okay? So let's try to remember, the minimal optimal time is square root of r times n. Okay, so we have this, excuse me, nice algorithm that can solve, that has been used for many, many years. Why do we have to come up with a new algorithm? It works perfectly fine. Well, it's a bit strange. So in the case when, so here on this chart, I have the dependency, how much memory do you need, depending on the ratio of the cost of the two functions, if you want to find the collision in optimal time. So this is log of R, this is log of M. So when log of R equals 0, in other words, when R equals 1, in other words, the balanced case, so when the two functions are balanced, we don't need any memory to find the collision. And now look at this. We increase R slightly, a little bit we increase, and then the required amount of memory jumps to square root of n. So even though we increase slightly, the memory jumps to square root of n. And as you can see, it's kind of counterintuitive. The larger the ratio between the two functions, the less memory we need. So imagine one of the functions is 4 times more expensive, only 4 times more expensive. And then in order to produce the collisions in optimal time, we need square root of n memory. Okay, so because of this kind of discrepancy, we are trying to come up with a new algorithm. Okay, so let's take a look at the new algorithm. So the new algorithm combines two ideas. The first is unbalanced interleaving or unbalanced selection function. And the second one is one-shot Wiener parallel collision search. So let's first take a look at the first idea. So as I mentioned before, in the balance case, how we find collisions between two balances, of course, we use the Floyd cycle finding algorithm. In other words, we define a new function, h of x. We, depending on some selection function that's either 0 or 1, so h of x either equals f of x or g of x, depending on this function that outputs 0 and 1 with equal probability of 1/2. Okay, and then we run Floyd for this function h of x, we find a collision. And after a final collision, we check if it's a collision between FF or FG or GF or GG. So in half of the cases, it's the good collision that we are looking for. So if it's a bad collision, we have to repeat the search. On average, we have to repeat the search only twice. So put this into perspective, this is your function F, this is the raw, this is the cycle finding algorithm. So as you can see, it evaluates either G or F randomly. And then once we find a collision, which is here, let's say, so it's between G and G, so this is not good, obviously we have to repeat again. And after repeat, we found a collision between F and G, good, we can use this as a collision. So this is the balanced case. Now, unbalanced interleaving happens, exactly everything is the same, just the selection function outputs 0, R times more than it outputs 1, meaning this function H of X equals F of X R times more often. And now when you produce a collision for h of x, it's a collision between f and f with much higher probability. If you want to be a collision between, the probability of this collision between f and g is only 1 divided by r. And that's why you have to repeat the search r times. Okay? So again, we put this into perspective. You can see now, excuse me, you have much more invocation of function f than g. So we run Floyd cycle finding algorithm, we find a collision, but of course it's between f and f. We run again, it's again f and f, and after repeating this around r times, we're gonna find a collision between f and g. Okay? So we have this unbalanced collision. Why don't we use this as a new algorithm for the search of unbalanced collisions? But the reason is, so you can see the complexity of this algorithm is one cycle finding costs square root of n, and we have to repeat this r times. So the complexity is r times square root of n. But optimal time complexity was square root of rn. So we kind of add factor of square root of r to the time complex. So this is not optimal. We need some more advanced ideas. And the second idea, and this is the more advanced idea, is instead of finding collisions with the Floyd cycle finding algorithm, we're going to use Van Oorschot-Wiener algorithm to find a collision. So this is very famous and very frequently used algorithm whenever you want to find multiple collisions. If you're looking for a single, you always run Floyd. If you want multiply, you always switch to Van Oorschot-Wiener parallel collision search, or as I like to call it, multiple collision search. So, however, unlike Floyd algorithm, this algorithm requires memory. So let's take a look how it works. It works in two phases. In the first phase, you build a hash table. So basically, you start with 2 to the m random points, and you iteratively, so assume you're trying to find a collision for some function f. So you start with 2 to the m random points, and you iteratively evaluate the function f on those points. You build for each of the points, you build a chain that's, sorry. Build a chain of length 2 to the n minus m divided by 2. And then you store in a hash table only the n, and the, sorry, only the ending and the beginning points of each chain, okay? So we create a hash table. And then when we are trying to find a collision, we take a random value and start evaluating, again, building this iterative chain. And every time we extend by one value, we check if the newly constructed value coincides with one of the stored points of the chains. So if it does coincide, obviously it collided this chain somewhere with this chain. And because this value we also have in the table, we can backtrack and find where collision occurred, and thus we can find the collision for f. So as you can see, during the construction of the table, it has 2 to the n points. The length of each chain was 2 to the n minus m divided by 2. If you multiply this thing, you can see that when we were constructing the table, we passed this many values. And if the length of this chain, and because in total there are 2 to the n values, if the length of this chain is 2 to the n divided by how many points here, we get if the length of the chain is this much, then on average we're going to find one collision, so the algorithm works nicely. So the total time complexity to build a hash table and find collisions, so to build a hash table is 2 to the n plus m divided by 2 and requires 2 to the n memory. And to find s collisions, s time, we have to find a collision search algorithm. For one, we pay 2 to the n minus m divided by 2. And now we can present our new algorithm for unbalanced collision search, excuse me, or unbalanced meet in the middle. So we define the function h is unbalanced interleaving between f and g, and this sigma outputs r times more 0 than 1. So basically, h of x equals f of x r times more frequently than g of x. And then for this function h of x, we construct hash table according to the Van Oorschot-Wiener algorithm with this many entries, this much memory. And then we find a collision for h of x. If it's collision for f and g, excellent. If it's not, we have to repeat the collision search algorithm. So basically, because h of x equals f of x r times more often, we have to find on average r collisions in order to find the to solve the unbalanced collision search problem. So again, to put this into perspective, this is the hash table. So again, as you can see, there are many more evaluations of f than g. Now the whole trick why this thing works. See here, even though I have many more f's than g, but keep in mind the cost of g is r times more than the cost of f. So basically, how much I paid here, I paid the same time complexity for f and for g. That's the whole trick why the whole kind of algorithm works, because of the construction of the hash table. And then, of course, I find a collision. I check, no, it's a collision between F and F. I find another collision, no, between F and F. And after repeating this odd times, I'm going to get a collision between F and G and solve the unbalanced collision search problem. So the total memory complexity to the M, this much we pay for the construction of the table, this much to find our collisions. When this number is larger than this number, in other words, when M does not exceed R, then we end up with a very nice trade-off that says T squared M equals R squared M. Okay. So in order to solve the unbalanced collision search problem, you can use this algorithm which follows this trade-off curve. It's a bit familiar. So this algorithm, in comparison to the standard meet-in-the-middle algorithm, has a better time for certain values of M, better memory for certain values of M, and what's most important, or one of the most important things, is the unbalanced collision search, but one of the functions is R times more expensive than the other function, can be solved in the optimal time, T equals square root of Rn, with not more than R memory, okay? So this is the Floyd for the balance case. This is the old meet in the middle, the standard meet in the middle, and this is our new algorithm. When we are trying to find the collision in optimal time. Okay, so now actually the amount of memory is not 2 to the n divided by 2 around when the ratio of cost is close to 1, but actually the smaller the ratio, the less memory we need. So obviously here, from 0 to 1/3, our new algorithm outperforms the standard meet-in-the-middle algorithm in terms of memory. However, you should also know that sometimes in some of the problems, the ratio R of the cost of the two functions depends on the memory. So you cannot just simply use the trade-off that I presented. So you have to come up with a new trade-off. And also, the new algorithm will not work if one of the functions is given as sets. Okay, because in order to work, we have to evaluate both f and g on certain random points. And because we need to evaluate on random points, we cannot use our algorithm in a known plaintext attack. It's always chosen plaintext. Also, in some papers I've seen, some of the people say, we actually do not care about memory complexity, we're just interested in time complexity. If that's the case, keep in mind, both the standard and the new algorithm, they achieve the minimal time complexity. It cannot go any lower. So if you don't care about the memory, you can just ignore the new algorithm. If you do care, you should probably take a look. But keep in mind, the algorithms that use infeasible amount of memory, they are completely entirely useless in practice. So you should care about memory. So the new algorithm may replace the standard, depending on the ratio R, as we saw from the chart. And in our paper, we have certain number of applications. You can take a look there. We, of course, didn't go through all the papers that use standard meet-in-the-middle algorithm and try to replace with R, because it's kind of trivial to do so. What's more interesting, actually, certain balanced collision search problems can be reduced to unbalanced and then solved using our algorithm. For example, when you're trying to find collisions between two functions, but for one of the functions you have to pay data complexity. So each evaluation of the function means one query to the cipher. So if you want to reduce the number of queries, you want kind of to switch to the unbalanced case, and then you can use our algorithm. Or if one of the functions has a reduced domain size, again, this is reducible to unbalanced collision search. And to conclude, you should consider a new algorithm whenever you're dealing with unbalanced meet-in-the-middle problems. The rule of the thumb is the ratio of cost of the two functions is less than 2 to the n divided by 3, then probably you should use our algorithm than the standard meet-in-the-middle algorithm. In some of the open problems, you can try to find more tricky cases, use cases of the new algorithm, and maybe try a new algorithm for the known plaintext case, so basically when one of the functions is given as a set. That will be really nice. And that's all. Thank you.
Any question and comment?
small comment about the case in which the function g is a function, not a permutation, not uniquely invertible. If you are trying to build the tree backwards, actually it has only a linear number of possible values. So if I go back for t steps, the expected size of the number of predecessors, which are t away from the final point, is only order t. Because even if I try to go back,
yes, and
I got
some of them,
two or three possible values, some of them might not have any predecessors,
yes,
and therefore some branches die out. And this is a well-known combinatorial property, that actually the number of predecessors, even if you go a very long way backwards, is very limited.
Yes.
So you might want to use it in your attack, even when you have a set.
Okay.
Comment on the question? I have one question.
Yes.
In your algorithm, you consider two functions, f and g. How about the more function, three and four functions for general bus problem? Can be applied?
Well, three is terrible, actually. We cannot do anything for three. Four, we can do something, you know, because four is kind of 2 plus 2. Three is one of the most interesting problems I think we have and everybody in computer science has. But no, I don't even know for case four. Probably something can be done. I cannot say it right now.
Okay, let's thank speak again.